tentar.
Mas se quisesse, pudesse passar por Calhuz.
Southern country, I come from the north.
Yeah. Sí.
Anteriores ao fim da ocupação,
reconhecer a extraordinária persistência com que o povo de Timor assumiu a causa da sua identidade. Em relação ao Presidente dos Estados Unidos, Bill Clinton, assumiu a absoluta urgência da tomada internacional de decisão que fosse decisiva e definitiva para o pleno reconhecimento da independência de Timor-Leste. Fizemos um cordão humano, fizemos, sobretudo, expressão racional, emocional, efetiva do valor dessa independência. E acreditámos todos nesses anos do final do século passado e do início deste século, até ao fim formal da ocupação em 20 de maio de 2002, fizemos todos causa comum pela afirmação do direito internacional. De um direito internacional capaz de respeitar a autodeterminação dos povos, capaz de respeitar o valor dos direitos humanos. E sabemos que a autodeterminação dos povos, o respeito pela sua identidade e a causa dos direitos humanos continuam prementes nos dias que passam. Porventura, cada vez mais prementes. E outros povos, noutras latitudes, continuam também à espera das possibilidades de afirmação do seu direito à autodeterminação. Os casos, que não vou citar extensivamente, mas a título emblemático, como são os da Palestina ou os do Saara Ocidental, bem demonstram como essa causa continua a ser uma causa bem atual, uma causa de todos os dias. Mas os dias que correm são dias de grande preocupação. Sentimos que os valores humanistas, os valores precisamente do reconhecimento internacional dos direitos humanos, tendem a ser postos mais uma vez em causa e mais uma vez em crise. Somos certamente todos partidários do princípio da soberania nacional. Somos certamente todos partidários do direito dos povos a assumirem o seu próprio destino. Mas eu vejo com preocupação que uma certa interpretação do que possa ser a soberania nacional tende a conduzir à diminuição da relevância dos direitos humanos e da solidariedade internacional na defesa desses mesmos direitos humanos. Em certas plataformas internacionais, porventura no âmbito das Nações Unidas, mas ao nível parlamentar, como mais me compete, gostaria de destacar a União Interparlamentar, plataforma que conjuga os parlamentos do conjunto das nações, vejo com preocupação como certos conceitos de democracia tendem a desvalorizar aqueles princípios que consideramos absolutamente inerentes ao valor da democracia. O valor da separação de poderes, o valor da proteção dos direitos fundamentais, consequentemente, o respeito pelas liberdades pessoais e pelas liberdades coletivas. E será importante que possamos, em cada circunstância em que isso está ao nosso alcance, continuarmos a valorizar esses direitos e a assumir que o respeito pela soberania nacional dos Estados não deve perder de vista a importância da solidariedade internacional pelos direitos humanos.
Muito bom dia a todos. Nós estamos um pouco atrasados, mas passo imediatamente à apresentação dos dois oradores deste painel. Cabral é o coordenador da Junta da Minuso, pela Frente Polisário, pela República Social e Democrática. E vai, portanto, falar sobre a situação atual do processo de paz da ONU no Saara Ocidental, que é uma questão, como eu costumo dizer, igual ao Timor-Leste, igual como duas gotas de água.
Thank you, dear friends. I want to thank all the members of the platform of jurists of East Timor on the occasion of the 25th anniversary of its foundation. I want also to congratulate our brothers and friends and brothers from Democratic Republic of East Timor for their for recovering independence and sovereignty on their land, but also to thank the government of Portugal of its assuming its responsibility, historical responsibility, and correcting the mistake of 1975 through its involvement in favor of the self-determination of the people of East Timor. And my hope is others will follow the track of Portugal in this case of decolonization. The Court of Justice in a case brought by the Frente Polisario on the European Union-Morocco trade agreement joined the ranks of the International Court of Justice, the United Nations and the African Union in upholding the long-standing and inequivocal position that Morocco has no sovereignty over Western Sahara. The European Court determined that the Sahrawi people have inherent right to self-determination, and crucially, it confirmed our right to protect and preserve our right and interest in the natural resources of our territory and waters. As a result of the 18 May 2017, Panama authorities detained a ship bound for Canada containing phosphate illegally mined by a state-owned Moroccan company in occupied Western Sahara. Meanwhile, South Africa authorities extend their hold on a ship containing 54,000 tons of phosphate rock from Western Sahara bound for New Zealand, pending a court decision. These seizures represent a major victory in the battle to halt the illegal exploitation of Western Sahara natural resources. But we need more such seizure, and we must ensure that the European Union and the wider international community does not undermine the impact of these seizures on Morocco by seeking to find ways around the European legal ruling. When Morocco feels the economic and political consequences of its illegal action, only then might it be compelled to enter into genuine negotiation.
Vamos passar agora para outra questão, que é a da Papua Ocidental. Tem muitas semelhanças também com a questão de Timor-Leste. E uma delas, que é óbvia, é de que a Indonésia, também aqui, que está do lado errado e contrária, no fundo, ao direito internacional. Quem vai falar agora é Leoni Tanghanha. Corretamente. Ela é membro do Movimento Unido de Libertação da Papua Ocidental e vive, tal como eu, em Haia, na Holanda, a 20 km da minha casa.
My name is Leoni Tanghanha. I am a West Papuan, based in the Netherlands. My task today is to give some basic information about what is happening in West Papua, an issue whose time has come. So the West Papua is the western half of the island of New Guinea, It is not very far from Timor-Leste, and it is a very vast area. It is about four times Portugal, seven times the Netherlands. It's big. It is very vast. It has a culture, a variety of languages. It is, but it is also a territory of Indonesia. We chose some national symbols, which were a different flag, a national anthem, but also a way to call our country, which is West Papua. And this happened in 1961. In December 1961, the 1st of December, the Dutch recognized that we were going to become independent. They also promised us that a couple of years after all this preparation, we would be able to become independent. So on the 1st of December, our flag, which at the time was only recognized as a territorial flag because we were still a colony of the Netherlands, was basically flew in the air together with the Dutch flag because we were still a Dutch colony. Our national anthem was sung and our country received the name West Papua. Just 19 days that flag was allowed to fly because straight away Indonesia decided that it wanted to claim that territory as well. And they claimed that they were basically liberating West Papuans from the Dutch colonial power, and they were freeing it. But that's not how the West Papuans have seen it throughout the years. West Papua is also becoming a minority in its own country, with the arrival of thousands and thousands of Indonesians from other islands. By 2030, we might be maybe 15% of the population in our own country. An observer said, today West Papua is an Indonesian colony. That means West Papua's resources that belong to the people of West Papua are used and exploited by somebody else. And that is very true. The forests are basically used by somebody else. So the main organization, the mother organization, is the OPM, which was formed in 1965. It's probably the one that most of you would have heard of. It's Organisasi Papua Merdeka. It has been fighting since the 60s with everything, with very little weapon, little publicity also, but it is still fighting. There is a military wing and a political wing to it. The central objective of the OPM is to liberate the people of West Papua from Indonesian colonialism, discrimination, exploitation, and to establish a democratic, just, peaceful, and prosperous independent West Papua. As the OPM went, other institutions have come to support these endeavors. The West Papua National Coalition for Liberation came up in 2005, which directed some of the political activities of the OPM and counted a lot on civil society organizations within West Papua. The National Committee for West Papua is another organization which you know most, I think, from the pictures of youth demonstrating in the streets of Jayapura and in other big cities of West Papua.
The violation on human rights were state programmed by military governments in our subcontinent in the 70s. All the executive powers, all the governments were exerted by militaries, except in Colombia, that has a long tradition of democracy, but a strong guerrilla struggle from the late 40s. It was a process called the Bogotazo, and the killing of a prominent politician, Dr. Galán, that time, and Venezuela. In the 70s, Venezuela was an imperfect democracy, but was working well with two political parties. But at that time, all our governments in South America and in Central America too, except Costa Rica and Panama, were exercised by military force.